Good morning and welcome to our time of worship here at First Methodist. Welcome to our online church family as well. Well, 3 weeks after the fact, we're still at the point where we can take another deep breath and just kind of, we're here with the lights on and the air conditioning on, and it's a beautiful thing. I'm not been surprised. I've been very grateful for the response that you have offered to people who are in need. We just see it all over the place here. Generosity of your time, generosity of your resources. I have over the last couple of weeks, not just me, a couple of others, but we've given out hundreds of dollars of gift cards to people, not just within our church family, but others who lost a lot in the power outages and things. We've had people that have gone over and helped chainsaw down trees and clean up yards. We've given away a lot of items. We still have a lot of items left in Cooper Hall. At the end of the service, if you have a need of any kind and you can use anything that's in there, we would encourage you to take it home and put it to good use. Or if you have a neighbor, you have a friend, someone in your community, someone you work with, someone you play sports with, whatever that is, that's what it's there for. One of the things that I've heard the last couple of weeks as we've tried to bless people and help them is they say, oh, no, there's got to be someone much more needy than I am. Well, that may be the case, but they're not here and you are here, and that's what this stuff is for. I don't want anyone to feel guilty about taking a flood bucket. We have probably 10 or 15 left filled with bleach and gloves and cleaning supplies, or the window cleaners, or the bleach, or the clothes. We still have lots of clothes and shoes. Even if it's not for yourself, for someone you know that might have a need, it has been donated for this time of need. So after the service is done, go over to Cooper Hall, get some of those resources. If we empty out of those resources and we need more, we'll get more. We've been working with some great partners like Faith Responders and others who have blessed us with resources. But that's what they're here for, and would encourage you to do that. You may be wondering, some of you came in and you noticed around all of our doors, you know, we've got beautiful new mats on all of our doors into the sanctuary and carpet underneath those mats. And why would we have brand new mats when we're missing shingles and soffit? And the mat project is about 2 months old, so just know that was in way before the hurricanes came through, but they are beautiful. I will say that with the new doormats here in the sanctuary, not so bad in Cooper Hall and the Ed Building, but with here, we're going to have to adjust the door sweeps a little bit. So just make sure that when you open a door, when you're through it, you close the door, because a lot of these doors won't close automatically until we bring up our door sweeps a little bit. But we wanted to offer just more excellence to the Lord and what our facilities look like and how welcoming we are to guests and visitors who are here. And so we do celebrate that. Our trustees and our administrative council are working on getting bids for some things that we need to do around here. We really came through this quite well compared to many churches. We're missing some soffit. We've got some damaged fascia and some other flashings and things like that. And we do have to have roof inspections. We've got some missing shingles. We're not really sure where they are from. But all things considered, we're much better off than some. But I do want to say thank you to those of you who have given and are giving to our property preservation fund. 100% of what we have to do to repair after the hurricane will come from us. And some of you have stepped up already. And we're so grateful for that. And we thank you for that. One other change from the hurricane, just to remind you of, is our charge conference celebration. That was scheduled for a couple Saturdays ago. That's our church's annual business meeting. It's usually a pretty short meeting. But this year, we're combining it with a carry-in luncheon and a time of worship as well, as we're partnering with New Horizon Methodist Church just over in San Antonio. We're making this a charge conference celebration. That's Saturday, November 9th, and it's 12 noon. It's a carry-in for the luncheon. If you would RSVP by calling or emailing the church office, and that way we can prepare a main dish and refreshments that way. But just know that you're all welcome for that. It's a time of worship and a time of fellowship, time of eating, deepening friendships, making new friendships. We'd love to have you come there on November 9th. Today, we are beginning a new worship series. We're looking, as many of us are, to kind of get back to normal the best we can. And the best way to get back to normal is to get back into the systematic study of the Word of God as we worship Him together. And so starting today, we're doing a new five-week series on the book of 1 John in the Bible, near the very back. The writer John wrote the Gospel of John. We've got the 1 John, 2 John, 3 John, and then also Revelation. that he wrote under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. There are five chapters in 1 John. We're going to do a chapter a week. And today we're going to look at chapter 1. Next Sunday will be chapter 2. We're calling it so that we may know. Here's why we're doing this now. Apart from weather and hurricanes, the era that we live in, it's just a time of uncertainty. And you feel it, don't you? I mean, deep in your bones. It feels like everything is changing. It feels like the pace of change is accelerating. Nothing feels stable. Technology is changing our lives at an exponential rate. I mean, from the use of digital currency to what we drive and where we work, how we consume information, it's just evolving and changing. New social patterns, new political patterns, continually evolving. So how do we know anything for certain in today's world? Well, this first epistle of John, it stands strong in offering us assurance and confidence that we can know where we stand with God. We don't have to be uncertain. We can know for sure where we stand with God. We can be certain about Jesus Christ. We can be certain about eternal life. We can be certain that God is light, that God is love, and God is life. And so that's what 1 John was written for. And that's what we're going to begin studying today, so that we may know that we have eternal life. With that, I invite you to stand as you're able. It's time for us to begin worshiping the Lord together.
Good morning. And to those of you online, good morning to you as well. I am really pleased that you're joining us today. Our call to worship is adapted from Psalm 27, and it is responsive, so I will lead and you will respond. The Lord is the stronghold of our lives.
He is the light of our homes.
One thing we have asked of the Lord.
One thing do we seek in his house of worship.
That we may dwell in safety.
That we may all live in peace.
Join with us in song as we sing number 156, I Love to Tell the Story.
Jesus and his glory, of Jesus.
join me for our affirmation of faith? This is done in unison. It's probably on the wall behind me. We believe in one God, the Creator of the universe, in Jesus Christ, God's Son, our Savior, who lived and died among us that, through faith, he might always dwell in our hearts. We believe in the Holy Spirit, who in comfort or chastisement leads us to the will of God. We believe in the church, the community of the redeemed, gathered to follow Christ in mission and fellowship, stewardship, and service. We believe in the scriptures, the word of God, given for reproof, correction, guidance under salvation, and the maturity of the saints. We believe that God loves us, Christ died for us, the Holy Spirit remains with us, and the church on earth is joined with the church in glory in abounding praise of God.
As we go to the Lord in prayer this morning, just want to point out the beautiful flowers on the communion table, given in honor of Dave Hill's birthday a few days ago. We say happy birthday, happy belated birthday, Dave, to you. You can applaud that. That's all right. A lot of you know Dave. Dave and Roz lead our Stephen ministry here at the church. Just a tremendous ministry to come alongside people and help them in their times of need. And he mentioned it a couple Sundays ago. I'll mention it again. If you know of someone within our church family or outside who just needs someone to talk to as they process recovery from Hurricane Milton, Stephen Ministry would be a great first place to start. And that information, the contact information, can be found on our church website. I want to add three names to your prayer list this week. First of all, to pray for Buddy Allman. If you have been watching, reading the news last couple of weeks, there was an incident with a police car, I think a week ago Friday. One of the officers turned out to be okay. The other one's still in critical condition. And he's a Pasco County Sheriff's deputy. His name is Buddy Allman, a friend of one of our church members. And so we want to pray for Buddy and his family. And I want to also add Gene Williams to your list. Gene is dealing with something this morning. It should be okay, but we want to pray for God's healing in his life. I also got word from Jeannie Narum. Jeannie, many of you know, is our lay leader, not lay leader, she's our certified lay speaker here at the church, so she preaches on occasion. Jeannie was enjoying a beautiful vacation in Europe, still is, had an accidental fall. She's going to be okay, but she's hurt her knee and a couple of other things and has to deal with that, getting on an airplane to come back from Europe to the United States. So just pray for Jeannie that she can be mobile enough to get onto the plane and get here. She's going to be okay. But we want to lift her up this morning, get her home safely to us. Let's take everything that we've got, all of our thoughts, our concerns, our worries and fears, we offer it to the Lord in prayer. Let's do that this morning. Almighty God, as we have the past few weeks, we must continually praise you. We must thank you for your ongoing protection and your provision. Even though there are some of us that have lost certain aspects of what was ours, and damage to our homes, in a few cases cars and other things, you have given us this church family that we can look out for one another and we can care for one another. And Father, the one another's have been abundant these past few weeks. Thank you for looking out for us, and thank you for giving us a church family so that we can look out for one another. We pray that you will help us to continue to be aware of what's going on around us. To those who could use some tangible help. Those who could use an encouraging word, but they may be too shy to say anything. I feel like there are other people that may need it more. Father, help us just to be aware and alert so that we can be used by you to offer support and relief, to offer comfort, to offer encouragement. And Father, we just continue to pray for your church, not just our church, but your church, as it works here, as it works on the coast, as it works going all the way up through Georgia into North Carolina still, as they try to recover from Helene. Lord, use us. Show us how we need to be generous with our time and our resources to bless others. And then, Father, as we minister to others, if there are open doors to have spiritual conversations, keep our awareness of that as well, that we would look for those opportunities to tell someone the great difference that you have made in our lives through Jesus Christ, that we can speak of your great love, to tell the old story of Jesus and his love. Father, we have many people we're praying for healing. We lift them all up to you now, and we ask that you would meet them at their point of need. It might be physical healing. It might be emotional or spiritual or relational. But that you would hear all of our prayers for those whom we know and love. Increase our faith in you. Increase our trust in you. Increase our capacity to be used by you for your purposes in this world. All this we pray in Jesus' name, as together we pray the Lord's Prayer by saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Alone. Are you weary? Are you heavy heart?
We continue to worship with the giving of our tithes and our offerings. And again, just a word of thanks for your ongoing generosity. As the Lord leads you, we continue to make repairs around our campus. If you want to help with those repairs, you can use the envelopes, or if you give online, just designate it to our property preservation fund. We know that we'll have what we need when we need it. We'll get all the repairs done. But we're going to give all that we have given to the Lord this morning through our tithing, through our regular giving to the church, as well as those special offerings. We'll do that now. We just encourage you, as you're able, to use the online way of giving. It's very safe. It's very secure, and just makes it easy to give that gift to the Lord. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for what you have given us, for our lives, our family, our friends, the places where we live. And we just give some of this back to you as a way to bless your church, that your mission will be accomplished. Receive these gifts as our act of worship this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Please be seated. For a special presentation, I would like to invite our lay leader, Bonnie Hazlett, to come forward.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I want to read Numbers chapter 6, verses 24 through 26. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. As you all know, October is Pastor Appreciation Month. We are so blessed to have Pastor Steve. He came to us during the pandemic, and he guided us through the transition from United Methodist to Global Methodist. Now he will guide us as we heal from Hurricane Milton. Under his leadership, we have seen our church family grow. He has started the Wednesday night refuel meals and the Bible study groups. Under his leadership, he has brought new energy to our church. Now, Pastor Steve, we give you this gift to show our appreciation to you in a small way for all that you are doing for our church.
No speech, just thank you, and remain standing for our hymn of preparation. It is a blessing and an honor to be here, and I look forward to a much longer time, Lord willing, and hurricanes make possible to be here for a long time of serving you. I love you. Thank you.
Our hymn of preparation is number 374, Standing on the Promises.
Promises of God.
appointed.
It is now time in the service for us to dismiss the children through fifth grade. I see one little anxious fellow here. He can hardly wait to get to children's church. And the leader will meet you in the front of the sanctuary and go over to the classroom across the hall from the nursery. And after our service is over, your parents will come over there and join you. Today, as the pastor already has said, we begin a new worship series. Excuse me, I have a frog helping me. Working through the first epistle of John, chapter by chapter, for 5 weeks to learn how we can know for sure that we belong to God and will have eternal life. Accordingly, today's scripture is from 1 John chapter 1, though the key thought runs over into the first 2 verses of chapter 2. I am reading from the NIV Bible. It's the exact Bible that's in the pew, page 986, if you would like to follow along, or it's probably on the screen behind me. 1 John 1, 5 through 10, and then 2, 1 and 2. Light and darkness, sin and forgiveness. This is the message we have heard from him and declare to you. God is light. In him there is no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with him and yet walk in darkness, we lie and do not live out the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, purifies us from all sin. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. If we claim we have not sinned, we make him out a liar and his word not in us. 2. My dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anybody does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for our sins, but for all sins of the whole world. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Let me try something here. Let's see.
We're like, yeah.
Darkness. Kind of. Nightlight. Nightlights have come a long way since I was a child. I never had anything like that. Do you feel better? We've got a nightlight. Right? Did you have a nightlight as a child growing up? I did. There's just something about light that makes us feel better, right? Makes us feel safer, more secure. I had a nightlight. It wasn't a nice one like that. I had one that my dad made from a piece of walnut and a little fixture in it with an incandescent bulb that if you got too close to it, it would burn you. But it was a nightlight, right? And I needed it. As a kid, I didn't like sleeping in total darkness. I hated it, scared of it. In my childhood house, Dad built our house, and I was just back there last Sunday. Dad built our house in the mid-60s. And a fancy house, 3-bedroom, 1.5-bath, but all the bedrooms are upstairs. So in our house, you go up the stairs, first door to the left is my sister's bedroom. My sister's 3.5 years older than me. Turn to the right, you can go in that way to the bathroom. Or if you turn just a little bit more, you go into my parents' room. And then you go all the way down to the end of the hallway was my bedroom. And even though my sister's room was the first bedroom at the top of the stairs, when I was a child, I just knew that whenever Bigfoot or Frankenstein would sneak up the stairs to kill someone, He would bypass my sister's room and go straight to my bedroom and kill me first. Bigfoot or Frankenstein, I don't know what your nightmares were about. There you go. But that little nightlight that my dad made for me, it was sufficient to ward off the Bigfoot attacks and the Frankenstein attacks. Light does that, doesn't it? Makes things just a little bit better. Eventually, sorry, choir. Light. Eventually, I outgrew my fear of the dark, I think, sort of. Well, I can tell you this. There was a time at my friend's, I was a teenager, 16, 17, 18 years old, and a friend, their parents were away for the weekend, so of course we got together at their house, and it was a late Friday one night, 11 o'clock, midnight, 1 o'clock, I don't know, and we're sitting there in the darkness of this house watching Children of the Corn. Stephen King movie? And I was sitting on the edge of the couch in this dark house there, over there, and it's like this hallway that goes down through the kitchen and down all the way to the end, watching Children of the Corn. I was a little bit scared of the dark in that moment. Now, I have to, at home, I want to sleep in total darkness. I don't like any light at all. But if I'm in an unfamiliar environment, if I'm in a hotel room or somewhere else, I'm still not comfortable in total darkness. I will, before I go to bed, I'll turn on all the lights. I will check all the closets. I will pull back the shower curtain. I will check under the bed, and then I will leave a little light on somewhere so that I can fall asleep. Now, you may be thinking, you're just a little bit paranoid there, Steve, but yeah, my therapist says I'm making really good progress. It's all good. I don't think I'm alone. Who has a nightlight? Who's got a nightlight? Yeah. You say to people that it's so you don't stub your toe on a midnight run to the refrigerator. You're protecting yourself against Bigfoot and Frankenstein, aren't you? I know you are. We like light. We like light. Light is good. Light is good. Light represents a lot of good things. Physically, light gives us warmth. It gives us illumination. It gives us heat. Metaphorically, as we find it in this scripture that Connie read for us, light represents glory and truth and holiness. This is the sense in which the Apostle John uses light in his letter to Christians. It's a letter that we call John's first epistle, or 1 John, very simply. The John of 1 John was the Apostle John. It's the John that we read about in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. The Bible tells us he was the son of Zebedee. John was one of Jesus' inner circle. You know, Jesus had the 12, what we call apostles. They were disciples. But then he also had an inner circle of three. He had Peter, James, and John. History tells us that John lived to be an old age. He was the only disciple, original disciple, that lived to old age. He died around 100 AD, last surviving original apostle. And under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, John wrote five of the New Testament books. He gave us the Gospel of John. He gave us 1 John, 2 John, 3 John, and then Revelation. In his writing style, John loves to use pairs of opposite words to make his points. Words like life and death. Truth and falsehood, love and hate, and light and darkness. And that's what we see here. In this part of 1 John that was read for us, John says Christians are people who walk in the light. Now, what does that mean? Now, John makes it clear as we read through this that when he uses the phrase walking in the light, he means, first of all, if you have your Bibles turned with me, I'm not going to read it again, but we're going to go through this chapter by chapter, week by week here for 5 weeks. We're in 1 John chapter 1. It says this, it says, God is light. Chapter 1, verse 5, God is light. In him there is no darkness at all. There you see those contrasting words, light, darkness. God is light, in him there is no darkness at all. Now, light in most religions and cultures, it's a symbol of God, godliness, supernatural illumination. Now, why do you think that is? Well, it's because of the sun, right? It's because of the giant glowing orb up in the sky. We need the sun. We love the sun. A lot of us moved to Florida because of the sun. Amen? We love sunlight. Humans throughout history have understood the necessity of sun to life itself. The light and the warmth that the sun brings, the necessity of sunlight to grow food and all that. Now, I think there are a few things at the bottom of the ocean that don't need light in order to live, but like almost everything else. I mean, if you're a tree, if you're a soybean, if you're a fungus, if you're a human, you're dead without the sun. You've got to have the sun. Some religions had even thought that light in itself was literally a god or a goddess, and so they had a name for it in their pantheon of gods. The Egyptians worshipped the god Aten, the sun god. It was Aten, later on called Ra. The Greeks called that god Helios, later was called Apollo. Now, of course, John, in 1 John here, he's using light as a metaphor. He's not using it literally. John uses the word light to describe God's holy character. And since holiness is part of God's essential nature, he can say that God is light, and Jesus could say of himself, I am light. If you go back to the Gospel of John, chapter 8, it says, when Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Does that sound a little familiar? It's the same author. It's John. It's a different book. As one of Jesus' closest disciples, John remembered Jesus saying, I am the light of the world. And he records it not only in his gospel, but then he talks about it here in his letters. He uses the concepts of light and darkness in teaching about what it means to be a Christian. So that's the first thing to note about light. It says God is light, metaphorically. And then the second thing we note about light in this passage, it says that Christians are to walk in the light. He doesn't say that Christians sometimes have light, or sometimes walk in the light, and sometimes walk in the darkness. No, it says Christians walk in the light. Period. Full stop. By definition. No exceptions. Christians walk in the light. John writes that if we claim to be a Christian, if we claim to have fellowship with God, and yet we walk in the darkness, we are lying. Go to verse 6. Notice the words in verse 6 if you're there. A couple of words. You've got some contrasting words. You've got lie and you've got truth. Another set of contrasting words that John likes to use, lie and truth. John teaches us that if we live an unholy life, then we cannot have fellowship with the holy God. The key word here is holiness. Now, we know from our own experiences, we know looking at church history, that there have been fake claims to fellowship with God just throughout the history of the church, all times and all places. I mean, it's just always been that way. If you read about some of the occasions that the Apostle Paul had to deal with in writing his letters, Paul had to deal with a case of incest in the Corinthian church. And later on, lay down a list of sins for which church members should come under church discipline. And so here we get to John, this 1 John, he writes very clearly that if you claim to have fellowship with God, then that means your life is in God, who is light. Peter wrote about it a little bit in 1 Peter chapter 2. He says, but you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Having fellowship with God is the essence of the Christian life. Being a Christian, calling yourself a Christian, it's not just believing in some abstract deity or God figure. It's more than that. It's not even just believing in what Jesus did for us. Belief is important, but being a Christian is about a relationship. It's about the regular, ongoing fellowship that a person has with God through Jesus Christ. It's a way of life. Christians, by definition, walk in the light, which John explains is this holy character of God. As Frankenstein might say, he would say, light, good. Dark, bad. And then after saying that, he would sneak up the stairs past my sister's room and murder me quietly in the night. So John says our task then as Christians is to do a couple things here. We are, first of all, to allow the light to reveal our sins. If God is light and we are to walk in the light. What do? Well, according to 1 John, we allow the light to reveal our sins. Walking in the light doesn't mean that our every thought and every word and every deed is always holy. We know better than that. We should know better than that. In fact, John says in there, if we claim to be without sin, we're fooling ourselves, he says. If we claim to be without sin, not only are we fooling ourselves, we are calling God a liar. Not good. Verse 8, we see this word truth again. Verse 10, the word liar again. There we go, those contrasting words again, truth and liar. Now, here is where light gets uncomfortable. We are to allow God's light to reveal our sins. The nightlight, we like this. This is comforting, regardless of what color. This is comforting, right? This is diffused. It's peaceful. Especially in a darkened room, hotel room, bedroom, wherever you are. This is comfortable. We like that. Keeps us from stubbing our toes on the way to the bathroom. And this is enough light, I promise you. This will keep Frankenstein and Bigfoot at bay. It will hold them away. I'm living proof of that, right? But if the light gets too bright, this is really uncomfortable, isn't it? Yeah, don't shake your head at me. You bought the ticket. You got to stay and watch the whole show. Okay. This is uncomfortable. Balcony thinks they, oh, choir back here. Oh my gosh, that is bad. Yeah, that's uncomfortable. We like light, but not too much light. Too much light reveals every little speck and blemish, the stuff that we don't want to see. Right? In certain kinds of bright light, you get this really accurate view of like your hair and your skin. Have you ever gone to a hotel room that's got really penetrating light and it's a lot brighter than your bathroom in your home, and you look at the bathroom in the hotel room, it's like, oh my gosh, I look like that? You see every blemish on your skin and your hair. Oh, this is awful. I hate that. Turn the light down. It's the same with walking in the light of God. The more we walk directly in the light, the more that the light reveals our imperfections and our blemishes. But that's what the light of God is supposed to do. Back to the Gospel of John chapter 3. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but men love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that his deeds will be exposed. The Greek philosopher Plato wrote that we can easily forgive a child who is afraid of the dark. The real tragedy of life is when men are afraid of the light. Christian pretenders don't like the light. They're afraid of the light because they don't want their evil thoughts and words and deeds exposed. But Christians who truly are enjoying fellowship with God, who are truly walking in the light, we're not afraid of the light because we know that the light has a purpose. Just a little light is sufficient to ward off the attacks of Bigfoot and Frankenstein on scared little children. The light of God's holiness is sufficient to expose our evil thoughts, our words, and our deeds so that we can deal with them. Now, we don't like our sins being exposed. It makes us feel uncomfortable. It makes us feel guilty and ashamed, and it's supposed to. We should be ashamed of our sinfulness in the presence of God because God is holy and just. But as Christians who walk in the light, we shouldn't be afraid of the light. Because as John writes, he says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins. He will purify us from all unrighteousness. And that's the purpose of the light. That's the second thing we are to do. We are to regularly confess our sins for forgiveness and cleansing. And God will do it every time. John says, if anyone does sin, we've got an advocate with the Father. It's Jesus Christ, the righteous one. And it's by his sacrificial death that Jesus removed the penalty for our sin and made a way available to get back to God into a relationship that we were designed to have. And of course, God himself provided this sacrifice. John writes that forgiveness and cleansing, it's available to the whole world. It's available to everyone who's ever lived, but it's only enjoyed by those who repent and believe. Going back into the Old Testament, into Ezekiel chapter 18, it says, "Rid yourselves of all the offenses you have committed and get a new heart and a new spirit. Why will you die, O house of Israel? For I take no pleasure in the death of anyone, declares the sovereign Lord. Repent and live." It doesn't get more direct than that. Repent and live. See, confessing sins is not just saying that you're sorry. Confessing sins is agreeing with God that a particular act is sin, and in a sense, you're taking sides with God against yourself. But then what happens when we confess truly and sincerely? Then God forgives our sins, and he continues that process of making us holy, that process that began when the Holy Spirit first began his work in us when we first became Christians. You see, it allows the process of becoming more Christ-like, more holy, sanctified, to continue when we repent, when we regularly confess our sins and repent of them. Now, what happens if we don't? What happens if we make excuses for sin? If we refuse to acknowledge a particular act was sin? Well, what happens is, at that moment, we put up a barrier between us and God. There's a block. We cut ourselves off from his transforming power. It has been said that some people change their ways when they see the light, others only when they feel the heat. Proverbs 28:13 says, "He who conceals his sins does not prosper, but whoever confesses and renounces them finds mercy." Every time. If we confess our sins and turn from them, God will forgive us our sins. He will cleanse us from our sins, and then we'll keep walking in the light. The light will continue to reveal our sins, and we'll continue to confess them and turn from them, and God will continue to forgive us and cleanse us, and the pattern will continue, and we will continue to grow in holiness. We will live this Jesus way of life in the world, and by walking in God's light, you see, we live a life that brings honor to God. It's a journey. It's a process. So don't be afraid of the light. Don't be afraid of this light either. You can be afraid of the dark. Don't be afraid of the bright light. There's nothing you've ever thought, nothing you've ever said, nothing you've ever done that God can't and won't forgive and clean up. And so let's take a moment to do just that. I invite you to stand with me. And let's pray together. Stand as you're able. Let's ask God to search our hearts, to reveal what's there, what needs to be exposed, what needs to be brought out into the light. And we'll do this silently between us and God as I lead us in prayer. And then as God exposes what's on your heart that needs to be confessed, confess it, repent from it, turn from it. Allow God to not only forgive you, but to cleanse you and to make you holy. Let's pray. Almighty God, we give you permission in this moment to search our hearts and our minds. What is there that we are trying to hide from you? What have we done? What have we thought? What are we thinking? What have we said that we know was wrong? We want to run away from it. We want to hide it. We want to conceal it. But God, we give you permission to expose it in the bright light of your holiness now so that we can turn away from it. We can confess it, you can forgive us, and you can cleanse us. Hear our silent confessions, Almighty God. My friends, my brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, it is in the name of Jesus Christ, our advocate, that you are forgiven. You are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. Let's sing our closing hymn. Amen. Thanks for being here today. If you want to be ready for next Sunday, get in your Bibles and read 1 John chapter 2. We're going to go through it chapter by chapter so that we can be assured, so that we can know for sure where we stand with God. And if you walk in the light of God, He is yours and you are His. Quick reminder that if you have needs for hurricane relief, Cooper Hall will be open immediately after this service. Just head on over that way. Take whatever you need, whether it's for you or for a neighbor or someone you love. That's what it's there for. And as we go through even these next few weeks, if there are things that come up that our church can help you with, let us know. We want to be here for you. We want to be here for one another. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of our Heavenly Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit go with you all this week. Amen.